Hi, have you ever wondered why some people don't believe that the earth is round? Have you ever wanted to convince them that they were wrong? I mean, how is it possible that in 2020 we have to convince someone about earth's form? Today I'm going to show you 10 reasons why the earth is round. Who am I? Well, I'm your master today and I'm going to teach you how to fight a flat earther. You will be my warrior and you will honor me. Let's start. Number 1. Lunar eclipses. I'm sure every one of us has seen a lunar eclipse. A lunar eclipse occurs when the moon moves into the Earth's shadow. This can occur only when the sun, Earth, and moon are exactly or very closely aligned with Earth between the other two, and only on the night of a full moon. The type and length of a lunar eclipse depends on the moon's proximity to either node of its orbit. Unlike a solar eclipse, which can only be viewed from a relatively small area of the world, a lunar eclipse may be viewed from anywhere on the night side of Earth. Aristotle, who made quite a lot of observations about the spherical nature of the Earth, noted that during lunar eclipses, when the Earth's orbit places it directly between the Sun and the Moon, creating a shadow in the process, the shadow on the Moon's surface is round. This shadow is the planet. And it's a great clue about the spherical shape of the Earth. One might say that Earth is round, but it's not spherical. Since the Earth is rotating, see the Foucault pendulum experiment for a definite proof. If you are doubtful, the consistent oval shadow it produces in every lunar eclipse proves that the Earth is not only round, but spherical. Absolutely, utterly, beyond a shadow of a doubt. Not flat. Number 2. Ships and the horizon. If you go to a lake and there are boats on that lake, the further away a boat is, the more the bottom of the boat will disappear, and you basically will see just the mast of the boat. And as the boat goes further and further away, the last thing you will see is the very top of the mast of that boat. That's because the boat is actually going over the horizon that's curved, and that means that as it goes further and further away, you see less and less of the bottom of it. And more of the top of it. You can't see that with binoculars. This wouldn't happen if the Earth was flat. You would only see the boat getting smaller and smaller as it goes further and further away, but you would be able to see the whole thing with the same proportions. Imagine an ant walking along the surface of an orange into your field of view. If you look at the orange head-on, you will see the ant's body slowly rising up from the horizon because of the curvature of the orange. If you would do that experiment with the ant approaching along a long road rather than a round object, the effect would change. The ant would slowly materialize into view, depending on how sharp your vision is. Number 3. Varying of stars. Varying star constellations. This observation was originally made by Aristotle, 384 to 322 BCE, who declared the Earth was round, judging from the different constellations one sees while moving away from the equator. After returning from a trip to Egypt, Aristotle noted there are stars seen in Egypt and Cyprus, which are not seen in the northerly regions. This phenomenon can only be explained if humans were viewing the stars from a round surface. Aristotle continued, claiming that the sphere of the Earth is of no great size, for otherwise the effect of so slight a change of place would not be quickly apparent. The farther you go from the equator, the farther the known constellations go towards the horizon, to be replaced by different stars. This would not have happened if the world was flat. In other words, if you live in the northern hemisphere, you can see all of the constellations on the northern part of the sky, and maybe some of what is visible from the southern hemisphere. If you travel downward towards the equator, you'll be able to see more of the sky from the southern hemisphere's perspective, while also losing more of what you'd normally see in the northern hemisphere. The time of day is truly what affects how much of the sky you can see wherever you are. Since the sun only shines for about half the day, you lose sight of constellations blocked by sunlight. Plus, because the Earth is orbiting the sun, you can see different parts of the sky depending on the time of year. Even so, there are some things you can't see at all depending on which hemisphere you live in. This explains why eclipses, meteor showers, and other phenomena can only be seen in certain parts of the Earth. Number 4. Eratosthenes experiment. Eratosthenes will always be remembered for the calculation of the Earth's circumference circa 240 BC, using trigonometry and knowledge of the angle of elevation of the sun at noon in Alexandria and Syene, now Aswan, Egypt. The calculation is based on the assumption that the Earth is spherical and that the sun is so far away that its rays can be taken as parallel. Details of his method he published in a work on the measurement of the Earth, which unfortunately was lost. We know indirectly about his method from other authors. Before we begin, a few definitions. Tropic of Cancer is one of five major circles of latitude that mark maps of the Earth. The Tropic of Cancer current latitude is 23 degrees, 26 minutes, 22 seconds north of the equator. Local noon is when the sun is the highest in the sky and can be quite different from 12 noon on the clock. Solstice is an astronomical event that happens twice each year, when the tilt of the Earth's axis is most inclined towards or away from the sun. In the Northern Hemisphere, the maximum inclination towards the sun is around June 21st, the summer solstice, with the maximum inclination away around December 21st, the winter solstice. For the Southern Hemisphere, winter and summer solstices are exchanged. What matters for our experiment is the fact that on the summer solstice, local noon, the sun rays are just overhead, at a right angle to the ground on the Tropic of Cancer. Eratosthenes knew that on the summer solstice at local noon on the Tropic of Cancer, the sun would appear at the zenith directly overhead, sun elevation of 90 degrees, though Syene was slightly north of the tropic. He also knew from using a vertical stick and measuring the cast shadow that in his hometown of Alexandria, the angle of elevation of the sun would be 83 degrees, or 7 degrees south of the zenith at the same time. Assuming that Alexandria was due north of Syene, Alexandria is in fact on a more westerly longitude. He concluded, using the geometry of parallel lines, that the distance from Alexandria to Syene must be 7 out of 360 of the total circumference of the Earth. The distance between the cities was known from caravan travelings to be about 5,000 stadia. He established a final value of 700 stadia per degree, which implies a circumference of 252,000 stadia. The exact size of the stadion he used is no longer known. The common Attic stadion was about 185 meters, but it is generally believed that Eratosthenes' value corresponds to between 39,690 kilometers and 46,620 kilometers. The circumference of the Earth around the poles is now measured at around 40,008 kilometers. Eratosthenes' result is not bad at all. Very interesting is that the measurement of the distance between Alexandria and Syene is based on the estimated average speed of a caravan of camels that traveled this distance. Camels traveled the distance many times to obtain an average estimate of the distance. Whether this is true is not clear. By the way, there is a guy, Curtis Boat, that tried a similar experiment using a bike and two sticks. Why not try it yourself? Number 5. Seeing farther from higher. You can see farther from higher simply because the Earth is curved. On a flat surface, that would not be true. It is true because the Earth is spherical. If you go to a very flat area like western Kansas, on the ground you can see about 14 miles. If you go to the third floor of a building, you can now see over the horizon and see buildings that are 20 miles away. An example of seeing further from higher is the sunset. If you climb 100 feet at the moment when the sun goes below the horizon, then you will see the sun again. It is impossible to explain why you can't see further when you can climb higher unless the surface of the Earth curves downward away from you. There is a formula to determine how far you can see. 1.17 times the square root of h, height, equals distance, d. The process is 1. Measure h from your eyes to the ground and find the square root. 2. Multiply your answer by 1.17. 3. This equals d, distance to the horizon in nautical miles. Number 6. Ride a plane. If you've ever taken a trip out of the country, specifically long-distance trips, you could notice two interesting facts about planes and the Earth. 1. Planes can travel in a relatively straight line for a very long time and not fall off any edges. They can also circle the Earth without stopping. 2. If you look out the window on a transatlantic flight, you can, most of the times, see the curvature of the Earth on the horizon. The best view of the curvature used to be on the Concorde, but that plane's long gone. I can't wait to see the pictures from the new plane by Virgin Atlantic. The horizon should look curved, as it actually is from a distance. Number 7. Look at other planets. The Earth is different from other planets. That much is true. After all, we have life, and we haven't found any other planets with life yet. However, there are certain characteristics all planets have, and it will be quite logical to assume that if all planets have a certain way or show certain characteristics, specifically if those planets are in different places or were created under different circumstances, our planet is the same. In other words, if so many planets that were created in different locations and under different circumstances show the same property, our planet likely has the same property as well. All of our observations show that other planets are spherical, and since we know how they're created, it's also obvious why they take this shape. Unless we have a very good reason to think otherwise, which we don't, our planet is very likely the same. In 1610, Galileo Galilei observed the moons of Jupiter rotating around it. He described them as small planets orbiting a larger planet, a description and observation that was very different for the Church to accept, as it challenged a geocentric model where everything was supposed to revolve around the Earth. This observation also showed that the planets, Jupiter, Neptune, and later Venus, once observed too, are all spherical and all orbit the Sun. A flat planet, ours or any other planet, would be such an incredible observation that it would pretty much go against everything we know about how planets form and behave. It would not only change everything we know about planet formation, but also about star formation. Our Sun would have to behave quite differently to accommodate the flat Earth theory. And what we know of speeds and movements in space, like planets' orbits and the effects of gravity. In short, we don't just suspect that our planet is spherical, we know it. Number 8. The existence of time zones. We all experience some cycles, for example, night and day, alternating periods of light and dark that change over time. The path of the Sun changes throughout a year, following a slowly tilting pattern that lasts 1 year. Also, the time in New York, at the moment these words are written, is 12 p.m. The Sun is in the middle of the sky. In Beijing, China, it's midnight. The Sun is long gone. All of this can only be explained if the world is round and rotating around its own axis. If the Sun was a spotlight and the world was flat, we would see the Sun even if it didn't shine on top of us. Similarly, you can see the light coming out of a torch on the wall even though you are sitting in the dark. The only way to have two distinctly separate time zones, where there is complete darkness in one while there's light in the other, is if the world is spherical. Number 9. Seasons. Another cycle observed on Earth, which we call seasons, go a particular way in the Northern Hemisphere and the opposite way in the Southern Hemisphere. Why is that? This is because Earth's rotational axis is tilted with respect to the elliptical plane, the vertical, and it is going around the Sun, just like all the other planets. The seasons occur because of the amount of sunlight hitting one hemisphere versus the other at any given time in Earth's orbit. Number 10. Images from space. Over the last decades, we've launched satellites, probes, and people into space. Many of them transmit amazing images to our receivers on Earth. In all of these photos, the Earth is shown to be spherical. So please, now enjoy the moment and watch these amazing pictures we show you because you deserve it. That's all for this video. Thanks for watching, everyone. What would you say to a flat earther? What do you think about this video? Don't forget to like this video and subscribe to our channel. And don't forget to share. Science needs you and you need science. See you next time for another amazing video.